that if you have got a MS SQL database where you have a table which is consisting of the information like customer, product, amount and quantity, and this database having this table has got 2 trillion records. So I was asking you the question. Okay, no more conversations in the audio. So thing is that reply in the chat, everybody, just in wild case that if you actually put a query on the table, which is on the SQL database, that who are top 5 customers from this table. So tell me that, you know, how much time, just given wild case, how much time is going to take in order to reply to this query? Any idea, wild guess, everybody please do a wild guess, chat, type in the chat box. Yes, quick. What is the time to be taking for, you know, if you run this query that who are top 5 customers from the table which is having a 2 trillion records in the MS SQL database, how much time it is going to take in order to give that answer? Neela said more than 3 hours. So I would like to know from the rest of the paper. Quick chat. Pratik, depends on different factors. I just need a wild guess. What should be the timing as per wild guess? More than 4 hours. Surekha, around 2 hours. Arun, what about Pratik and Pradeep? Pratik, Pradeep, quick. Pratik said 2 minutes. Okay. What about Pradeep? Did not get anything from Pradeep. Fine. So the answer is basically, I mean, more or less, almost everybody apart from Pratik is actually near to the wild guess. That is, it's going to take more than 6 hours. Okay. Pratik, it doesn't matter. It is just a wild guess. Okay. So you can actually guess whatever you want. It doesn't mean that you need to be from the technical background. Doesn't matter at all. So whatever your wild guess, you can always tell that. Okay. So doesn't matter. Always be interactive so that so everybody is not coming from the same background, technical, non-technical, doesn't matter. You are anyway just learning a new subject, so all of our status is same. So always answer, even though it is wrong, doesn't matter, because we are actually discussing something, so answer can be wrong as well. Okay, so doesn't matter. So what I was discussing is that MS SQL database, in order to get that particular query of who are my top 5 customers among the 2 trillion record, is going to take more than 6 hours. Okay, now the same thing, same table is basically residing in HANA. So if I just recreate the scenario where basically what happened, instead of MS SQL database, I have got the same thing, you know, in HANA. Okay, so in that case, what happened, that my question is that I'm running this, actually the same table is basically is also residing in SAP HANA, and I am actually running the same query, who are my top 5 customers. This time is going to take, in case of HANA, is, you understand the difference? In the MS SQL database, it was going to take more than 6 hours, whereas in case of SAP HANA, if you are running the same query with the same volume of data, which is 2 trillion, it is going to take less than 6 seconds. So you understand the high, the level of high performance, isn't it? So you understand the level of high performance the tool is actually having. Okay. So next questions can come to your mind, you know, which you are going to ask me, is that why high performance? Yes, I understand you said HANA means high performance analytical application. That is, I understand. Everybody understand. Now tell me why this HANA is actually having high performance, whereas MS SQL database is actually, again, a database. It has got its tables and structures and everything, but it is not high performance. The difference is 6 hours and 6 seconds. How can it be? Okay. So thing is that what happened, the reason being why high performance, that is the next question. So fundamentally, if you see HANA, basically, and the first point is basically, it is an, what is that? IMDb, in memory database. What do you mean by that? In memory database, I'll come to that. Next point is that columnar database means the tables columns being stored over here in a columnar fashion, not in the row fashion. Okay, and similarly the third point is basically MPP, which is massive parallel processing. Okay, so these are the three features, fundamental features. The moment somebody will ask you that why you are recommending me HANA as a client, okay, as an architect or as a, you know, HANA consultant, what happened? Like, you know, if you're recommending a client that you should use HANA, so you should be obviously, you should be basically, you know, immediately you should be in a position to tell that why high performance, why HANA is basically high performance. There are three factors which are responsible for that. One is in-memory database, which means, say for example, earlier all these databases, like, you know, the SQL database, you talk about any other Informatica database, any database, you talk Oracle database, what happened, you know, there is basically a kind of a disk-based storage, isn't it? Like, you know, in the hard disk we used to store the data, right? But thing is that SAP has designed the database in such a manner that this complete functionality is happening into the RAM, which is in memory. So it is happening into the RAM instead of disk. Okay, and RAM is much, much, much more faster than the disk. First thing. Second thing is that RAM is also very, very cheap. Okay, so cost factor is also there. Second thing is that columnar database. Okay. Columnar database means, as I told you, that, you know, in the normal cases, what happened, any tables which been actually been stored into the database, RDBMS. So thing is that you know, it has been actually you know, columnar database, it is actually in the case of a, you know, this normal database like SQL, or as I just mentioned, that in case of you know, the database like, you know, Oracle, the data table structure is basically been you know, stored as a row based storage, like, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, it's basically stored as a row based storage. Whereas in case of a HANA database, actually you have got the two options, like, you know, the in the row based fashion also the table got stored, and then similarly in the column based fashion also the row got stored. But the columnar database is basically the one for which is basically HANA is high performance. Okay, third thing is that massive parallel processing. As I just mentioned, that massive parallel processing means that, you know, it is basically what happened, that, you know, it is not anything what you are processing, any data or any code what you are processing, it is actually not going sequentially. Like, once one process gets completed, then another process starts. So that is called sequential processing. But in case of HANA, it is massive parallel processing. Like, you know, even though one program is getting you know, processing, similarly parallelly another coding is also getting processed. So parallelly there are, say, like, you know, thousands of programs is getting processed parallelly. Okay, so massive parallel processing. So obviously, once you are actually not doing one thing sequentially, like, you know, I have finished one work and then the second work is starting, what happened? Of course, it is going to take more time. But parallelly, if you are running, say, like, you know, different jobs altogether, at the same time you are running 100 jobs together, what happened? Of course, you know, all the jobs are actually running on their own system, and it is going to finish one by one. So it is not dependent on each job is not dependent on the other job. So everybody is actually finishing their own job or own assignments, isn't it? So that is called massive parallel processing. Whereas in case of the other database, what happened? It is a sequential processing. Sequential processing means one after another. So Pratik, I am actually explaining that, you know, Pratik is asking why it is fast. So I'm just asking that why it is fast, that why high performance. I have given three reasons. One is in-memory database, one is columnar database, one is massive parallel processing. There are three features in SAP HANA, you know, as a solution. So the moment you are talking about high performance, okay, the moment you are talking about high performance, So there are these are the three reasons that you should tell, and and you are actually going to be into the you can actually in a position to recommend that why you should recommend HANA. Okay, so Pratik is asking one question that what is columnar database and why storing data in column is fast? Okay, Pratik, so we are going to see that in our next sessions. That today is just the introductory session, so we are just going to discuss that why, what are the features, and and of course we will be definitions and the comparisons we are going to see. Pratik is asking a question which is very and very intelligent question that definitely you should ask. That the question what he is asking is basically that why columnar database is faster than the row-based storage, which is a very obvious question going to come from you. Okay, so we are going to discuss all these points with example in our next sessions, because today we are this is an introductory session, so we are just going to discuss in a high level that why we are here to learn HANA as a database or as a solution. Okay, so thing is that just remember one more thing also, that for example in a computer, what's happened inside a computer, if you just look into a computer, what's happened, like you can see that that inside a computer is basically what happened, that there is something called CPU, which is a central processing unit, and the second thing which is present over there is basically RAM. Okay, and the third thing which is present there is basically disk. So thing is that inside the computer there, these are the three main parts which are basically responsible for execution of the codes. Okay, so earlier, as I just mentioned, or maybe in case of other databases, what happened that we used to store the data in the disk. Okay, now earlier what happened, disk was basically cheaper than RAM. So like maybe 10 years or 15 years down the line, if you're talking about that point of time, RAM was expensive. But over the period of time, what happened that RAM has become more cheaper than disk. So SAP started creating the in-memory database, and they tried to separate the container. So RAM is one type of container, disk is one type of container. So they have started experimenting and they have started recommending that instead of disk, you just choose to store your data, everything, in the RAM. First thing is that RAM is cheaper. Second important, it should be either way around. So the first important point why you should actually store or recommend RAM in order to store your data, the reason being that RAM is 100,000 times faster in processing the data. 100, this is the first reason actually. RAM is 100,000 times faster in processing, and data is kept closer to the CPU. If you see that the structure inside the structure, you can see CPU, RAM and disk. So if you see literally that RAM is basically closer to the CPU, because after CPU RAM is present and then disk. Okay, and this is basically, as I just mentioned, that it's basically, you can see that it is far from the CPU. That is one reason, the location. And second thing is that, because as you know that whatever you're storing, the processing actually happened into the central processing unit, okay, in the CPU actually. So first thing is that RAM is 100,000. The choosing of RAM, the decision of choosing RAM is first thing is that it is 100,000 times far processing. Second is that it is kept closer to. Third is that, as far as the disk, and if you compare the price of right now recent in the disk and the RAM, it is cheaper. Okay, so that is the main actually orientation. Okay, now thing is that the questions what you are actually talking about regarding that why, what is column oriented database? Okay, and So, and there is also storage of data is possible into the row based manner and the column based manner. Okay, so the next class, what we are going to do is that we are just going to see with an example that what is the difference between the column and the storage and the row based storage in HANA. Basically, we can actually store the data. You can actually create, or you can actually store data in HANA. You have got options of storing data into the row based fashion also, and at the same time you can actually store the data into the once I discussed also that HANA is basically a in-memory database. I said HANA is basically, so why are you learning HANA? First thing, and second thing is that second question is that why should you recommend HANA to your client? So of course, I mean, like while you are going to a client and so you are representing as a HANA modeler or HANA developer or HANA architect, so of course the expectation is that the client will ask you that, that for your recommendation. So now in that case, why should you recommend HANA as a solution to your client? Okay, that could be the questions. So the first point, why you are learning HANA, or say like, why you should basically recommending HANA to a client, is basically for its property of in-memory database. Remember, so in-memory database is something which means that, if you remember earlier, say like, as I told you the 17 years back, what happened is to we see that we have seen that, the data gets stored into the hard disk, isn't it? Like we used to get Seagate hard disk, and there are different companies available into the market, and we used to purchase additional hard disk as well, additional server space as well. But we never talked about memory because memory was very expensive at that point of time. But due course of time, the scenario got fully changed, and what happened? The memory becomes very, very cheaper compared to the hard disk. So SAP has designed the database in such a manner that it completely running into the in-memory solution, in-memory database. Okay, so as I just mentioned that the primary way of storing data was basically into the hard disk, before 17 years back. But once SAP and the HANA price, sorry, that RAM price got dropped down, what happened that that point of time, SAP has basically started designing the RAM in such a manner that, it has become an integrated part of your solution in order to store the data. Okay, so this is basically a separate container. So like hard disk is a container to store the data. Similarly, RAM is also another container to store the data. Okay, the first point, if somebody will ask you that why it is in memory database, in RAM, because why people are SAP is recommending to use the in memory database. Okay, the first point you should tell that RAM is basically 100,000 times faster in processing, and data is basically kept close to the CPU. Say for example, if you just see an internal structure of a computer, so for example, so like this is a computer, for example, what you have, and if you see the internal structure of it, you can see that, the first one is basically the CPU. Secondly, the second position, it is basically RAM, and then the disk. I mean, that is the way the alignments is inside the computer. Now thing is that why RAM, why in-memory database? If somebody will ask you, then you should immediately answer that the first point is that RAM is 100,000 times faster in processing, and data is kept closer to the CPU. So you can see that disk is basically far away from the CPU, whereas RAM is basically the one which is basically closer to the CPU. So if you're storing something into the RAM, what happened for central processing unit is basically, as far our hardware concept is concerned, as you know that in the central processing unit, what happened, any kind of program gets processed or executed for further result, right? So in the RAM, the data you are storing, that is getting processed into the CPU and giving you some final output. So technically, or say like from the hardware point of view, you can see that RAM is basically closer to the CPU. So first point, RAM is 100,000 times faster in nature than in processing, and data escape closer to the CPU. That is the second point. And third point is, as I just mentioned, the RAM has become cheaper than the hard disk. So that is also another reason for considering RAM as a in storing the database, the full database we are storing into the RAM. That is the first point of HANA. Okay, and this is the difference between another this system, HANA system, and any other system. Okay, because Oracle and all, they don't use any in-memory database concept. They use it into the store the data into the database. Second point is something called columnar DB. Columnar DB, which means columnar database. What does it mean? Columnar database is basically what? Columnar database, see, like, you know, in a, if you are coming from the, say, like, in a normal RDBMS concept, like in a relational database concept, that you know how the data is stored in a table, for example. So, in general, it is basically row wise. Row wise means, for example, let us just try to see one example. Say, for example, you have got customer, you have got product, you have got amount, and you have got quantity. Say, for example, this is the header. Okay, now you have got the data like customer, records like customer, product like P01, amount say like 100, and so quantity like 10. Whereas your second record is consisting of customer C02 with the products P02 and say like 220. Say for example, quantity 20. Now, so this is the a table, for example. Okay, and this is a row based table I mentioned. Okay, and I said I'm discussing about columnar database table or columnar database, and this is an example. What I'm discussing right now is a row based table. Like in a row based table, like in, what is the example of a row based table? Any kind of relational database table, if you talk about, apart from SAP or non-SAP, forget about SAP or non-SAP. So we all know relational database tables, like, you know, where the data gets stored. So how the data gets stored in a normal table, that is into this type of row based fashion. Okay, now try to understand that this is the way row based table get stored data. Okay, I mean, this is the normal way, and this is the normal table. Any normal table is basically the row based table in nature. Okay, now I'm saying that, you know, when you try to insert one more row into the table, like say, for example, first you had got C01, that particular record, and after that you have got the C02 record. Okay, now thing is that while you were storing that C02 record into the table, what is going to happen, that the data is getting stored into the backend file. So there is a backend file gets generated where the data is getting stored. Now, for example, if we run the query on this table, say for example, who is the top customer? Say for example, who is the top customer? So looking at the table, you can see that who is the top customer? Krishna, who is the top customer if you look into the table? Okay, Surekha, who is the top customer? C01 is the top customer. Why? Any other answer? I said, who is the top customer? So Krishna said C01 is the top customer. So are you agreeing with him or any other answer? Venkat said C02 amount is 200. Absolutely correct. Because based on the amount only, we are deciding who is the top customer. So Krishna, just look into this point. C01, this particular customer is actually having the amount value is 100, whereas C02 is basically having the customer C02 is having the amount like 200. So 200 is more than 100. So that is the reason C02 is basically the customer who is a top, in this two records table. C02 is basically the top customer based on his amount value 200. Venkat, absolutely correct. Okay, so did you understand other rest of the members? Are you understanding? If there is any confusion, you can interrupt and ask me. Okay, Surekha, are you able to follow? Okay, so
yeah.
Thing is that, okay, fine, thanks. Now, this is the process of storing the data. Now, thing is that what happened, so what I said, what I asked, that when I try to insert one row in the table, say like for example C02 table record, it stored the data into the backend file, first thing. Second thing is that I run a query on this table who is the top customer. Okay, so in order to, based on this amount 200, the C02 is the top customer, which is correct. Now, in order to get that answer, in order to get this answer, what is happening is, what the system has to do, what the system is doing actually in the background, you just need to understand that the system is basically scanning the entire file. Say for example, I have just mentioned two records into this table, but for example, you say this table has got 2 trillion records. Okay, now just to get that answer, like who is my top customer, what is happening, what the system is doing into the background, system is basically, what it is doing is that it has to go or scan the entire file line by line, because we dump the entire table data into one single file. This is one single file which is consisting of the entire 2 trillion records. Now, how do I know that, you know, who is my top five customer, top customers, for example, unless and until I read each and every line, isn't it? I need to read each and every record sequentially. First record, second record, third record, fourth record, fifth record. Then after that only, I'm making a sort and then I'm trying to find out who is my top customer based on the amount value. So I am reading each and every entire file by reading each and every line or each and every record. Okay, so tell me that, of course you understand that the moment you are actually having a sequential read, that is called a sequential read, right? Because sequentially line by line you are reading in order to get your query answered. So of course, think about your performance, think about the execution time. Okay, now the same information, I'm using the same information into in a columnar database. Okay, now how columnar database, what I'm talking about, this is a row based, this is an example of a row based table, that is fine, I understand. Now how about, what about a columnar table? Okay, columnar table, how the data gets stored? With the same example, I'm using the same example. Okay, I'm not changing the example. In case of a columnar table, how the data gets stored? How many columns we have? 4 columns, right? Customer, product, amount, and quantity. So in case of a columnar table, it will create 4 columns based on your columns. Okay, for each column, it will generate a separate file. Understand the difference. The whole thing in case of a row based table basically gets stored into a single file, but in case of a columnar table, what happened, we'll get 4 columns based on your columns. Okay, first thing. Second thing is that each column, it generates a separate file. So just try to see that what exactly I'm talking about. In case of a columnar table, it will break down to 4 column, okay, 4 column, 4 files. So what 4 files it is consisting of? It is consisting of, say like, So just try to understand the difference. What is happening is that for each and every column, I am actually creating a separate file. So for customer, for amount, for product, okay, I have got separate file is getting generated in case of a column and a table. The moment you are making choosing the table type is columnar, what is happening, this is the way the your information is getting stored, okay? But the same information what you have used into a row based table, right? Now what is the benefit? Let us just see the benefit. So what are these? These are the four files got generated. This one is for customer, this is for product, this is for amount, and this is for quantity. So four, instead of one file, there are four files got generated. Okay, now I am running the same query, who is the top customer? Same query I am running over here, and this is a column in a table. Okay, and this is the example of a row based table. Okay, but in the column in a table, what happened, based on your four columns, you can see that there are four files got generated. That is fine. And I am running the same query, who is the top customer, in this columnar table. So how it will basically read? Thing is that I said based on your amount, you are deciding who is my customer. So you are don't no need to use my product and quantity, because I am not considering these two as my parameters of to answer my, because if I just see my amount value and if I see my customer, then only by looking at these two columns only I can answer who is my top customer. So what happened, like in this case, just try to concentrate. But so for example, what you are doing is that directly your amount and your customer is basically what is happening, you can connect. So you can bypass this and this quantity, right? Don't need. So your amount and so this quantity and product you are actually not using, right? So this one and this one you are not using. Product and quantity, there is a strict no no. You have not used this quantity at all, and at the same time you have not used this product as all, at all. Okay. So this to this is a just a direct connectivity. You can get it. You can make a query. So customer and amount as a separate file. So based on your amount, you can identify your customers. You can bypass your product and quantity. Now, if you look this particular activity, so you understand that I have bypassed this product and quantity information. So is it advantageous? You find it not. The advantage is that it I have taken a shortcut to answer, get my query answered. So this is a shortcut. I said that based on my amount directly I gone to the customer to find out my query, top customer. So product quantity is not into the picture. So advantage is that I have taken a shortcut. Shortcut means less time, right? Shortcut means this is a less time. Of course, the kind of effort and kind of time consumption is what you expect from a row-based file just for this answer, this particular query is completely significantly got improved the moment you are having a column and a table. So HANA is one of the features is a column and a table. That is also one of the reasons the way it has been designed. And third point is basically over here is basically MPP. MPP means massive parallel processing. So what is massive parallel processing? Massive parallel processing is that something that, say for example, it is talking about, I talked about in case of a row based table, it is a sequential processing. Like each and every line you are reading, you are completing, then go to the next line, reading, completing, then go to the next line. For 2 trillion records, do it. Same activity. But what is massive parallel processing? So by name, by this definition, I can understand that massive, like, you know, it is getting, you know, in a very, very large manner. Okay. And parallel processing means multitasking. Once you are doing at home, we do multitasking, right? Sometimes, is it something that you are doing, a keep on doing a same thing, and you finish it, and then only you are going for some other task? We don't do it in such a manner, right? We do multitasking, right? Parallelly, we do many works together. Like, you know, while you're cooking, you can actually, you know, finish up some notes, or say, like, you know, you can finish up some your, you know, documentation activities, say, for example, while if you're working from home. So, for example, so it is not mandatory that your cooking has to be complete and then only you can complete your documentation, right? A very practical and simple example. So you can do the both tasks together, you know, while you are looking into the cooking, and you know, once it's getting completed, you can always complete that your documentation stuff, or say, like, you know, some kind of, you know, technical activity what you're doing is, or you are doing something else otherwise, or maybe cleaning the house. You can always do it parallelly. So that is called parallel processing. Okay. Now, parallel processing is that, you know, if you are there is any kind of data, or say, like, kind of algorithms or programs needs to be executed. So what happened that I mean, once a program is getting executed, parallelly another program is also getting executed. It is not dependent on each other, so that every program actually has got their own execution time, and but at the time of submission of the result, that also you need to understand. Say, for example, you are processing something as a parallelly, I understand that, but what about the result? Like, is it something that once a person once you know a CPU or a central processing unit, you know, finish a processing execution of a task, whether it is giving the result first to the output, or say to the HANA, or it is waiting for the another task to be completed, and then it is giving it, then only it is giving it. So the result of your parallel processing is basically on a you know, I should say that it is in a combined mode. The result you are giving in a combined manner, but the task what you are processing, the function what you are executing into HANA, is basically you are parallelly doing it. Okay, but at the time of submission of the result, that you are submitting altogether to the client, or say, like, to the system. Not to the client, to the system. Okay, so massive parallel processing is another point. Okay, we'll be seeing that into the details as well, that how massive parallel processing done. So, any questions on this in-memory database, columnar database, or massive parallel processing as far as HANA features is concerned? These are the main HANA features. Okay. So, like, is there any questions from Krishna, Pratik, Surekha, Venkat, or who else is there? No question. Ashwin,
Hello,
Arun.
Arun here, Anu.
Yes, tell me, Arun.
While querying this database in HANA, how is it going to perform? Is it going to be the usual relational database kind of SQL scripts to retrieve this data, or the query syntax is going to be different for this column and a database?
Okay, fine. So this is a good question. So, I mean, how the data is basically getting executed, and how will you get the data? So, like, you know, that is the questions from Arun. So, okay, but what about rest of the? I'm just giving you the answers, Arun. But what about others? Is there any, whatever we have discussed, is there any questions on that from the rest of the friends? Everybody is clear? I mean, what we are discussing? Fine. So let us just go to the another page. Right. Now, remember, once we are talking about SAP HANA, or say, like, you know, systems, you know, there are two types of SAP systems. Okay. There are two types of SAP systems. One is called traditional SAP systems. Example, what is traditional SAP system? So whoever is not from the non-SAP background, just try to understand. Earlier, we used to have SAP system called SAP ECC. You must have heard about it if you are actually know HANA, or so if you are actually you know, experimenting or researching on HANA. So like, you know, there's some terminologies like SAP BO, Business Object, SAP ECC. So this is basically one of the source of SAP HANA. This is actually one of the source systems or transaction system of SAP. It is the one of the transaction system means, which means in this system, usually users, they post the data. Okay. Like in the bank, in the banking, say like, for example, in a bank, what kind of technology they are using? So for example, they're using SAP technology. So if they're using SAP technology, that is what does it mean? It means that, you know, that the users, they are posting their daily transaction into the SAP ECC system. Okay, it is basically storing and acting as a database. So SAP ECC, and then, you know, SAP CRM, for example, you know, customer relationship management system. So these are basically the traditional SAP system. Okay, and the new SAP system is SAP HANA, the one which you've developed right now. So what is the difference between these two? The difference between these two is that SAP ECC, or this traditional SAP systems, are basically the way models or the way development gets stored over there. The category is code to model, whereas when I'm talking about our new SAP system, which is SAP HANA, the kind of architecture it has is basically model to code. So what is the difference between these two terminology? Means code to model. So when I'm saying this traditional SAP systems are, say, like, you know, code to model kind of, that is the architecture, is a code to model means, say, for example, if you are developing a model, we need to write a code first in order to generate a model. Very simple. What does it mean? Like, you got in this SAP ECC system, so for example, what you're doing is that you are writing some function module, for example, or writing some program in order to get some business logic. Simple. So for that, what you need to do to get, in order to get your business logic, what you need to do? You need to write some programs the way we write it into the other database systems. Like, you know, you have to write Java program. Why? Because you are going to achieve some kind of business logic or business report maybe at the end of the day. So code to model, you are coding in order to achieve your business model. What is your coding language? Coding language is clear. Advanced Business Application Programming. This is the language. I don't know whether you have heard about ABAP language or not, but you should. If SAP, in traditional SAP system, each and everything being written, any kind of business logic, any kind of programming is written not in Java, in ABAP, Advanced Business Application Programming. Advanced Business Application Programming is basically this is a programming language which has been used in the traditional SAP systems in order to write any program in order to achieve your business model. Come to new SAP system, which is SAP HANA. What you need to do is that we need to model first, system generate the model code, and this code gets generated automatically. Try to understand the difference. You have done a model by pick and choose the objects. Okay, so once we'll see the HANA system, we can see that, you know, on the left hand side you have got your objects, what you are picking and choosing into your right hand pen, and your model is ready and getting executed and get some result. But so you have just dragged and dropped, you have not written any kind of programming for that. But if you look into a special a button there, if you click on it, you can see that in the background, the moment you have done your model and save and activated, there is a background, in the background there is a code got generated automatically by the system. Okay, so coding language, if you see the background code which has been generated by the system, you can see that the code has been written in SQL script, right? So difference, you understand, code to model the traditional SAP system, and in the new SAP system is model to code, which means that first you model, activate, execute. The moment you are saving and activating your model, if you click on a particular button, you can see that system is actually generated an automatically a code, the moment you have done your modeling. Okay, so we create any business scenario, okay, and in the system, and then what happened, the codes get generated automatically in the background and using SQL script. So in case of a SAP native HANA, this is native HANA, remember that you have got the SQL script as a programming language, okay? Is that fine so far? So did you understand that? So Arun, as I just mentioned, that I think, did you get your answer? Like, how do you get your model, or how do you get your business logic written? That is that, you have got two options. For example, we all have two options. Like, you can drag and drop the objects and create your model. If that is basically sufficient for your business, creating your business model, that is fine. If it is not, then you have to write some programming language in order to write, in order to get your business logic, the way we do it into the other database systems also, right? For example, in code, you are writing in Java. Why? Because, you want to get some kind of business logic after, at the end of the day. So similarly, if there is a drag and drop options or graphical method, for example, just drag and drop will suffix your purpose. If it is not, then of course, in the last option is the coding option, because if you write a code, you can actually get all your query answered. But that is not the approach, because first you have to try that whether you can actually, with the available objects in HANA, whether you are able to draw up a model or not. If not, last option is basically coding. Because if you know that anything and everything can be achieved via code. But in case of that also, you have to have a performance challenge. So you have to, once you are writing the code, you have to maintain that, that best practices protocol, so that the code should not have any kind of performance issue. Yes, because HANA, if you are recommending somebody, majorly it is for the performance. For example, just a simple example what we discussed last week. Say, for example, you have got the kind of difference, just try to understand the kind of difference, the execution time difference it has, okay? That, say, for example, in the MS SQL, you have got 2 trillion data, MS SQL database, okay? Now you have got some records on customer, product and amount and quantity, and you would like to know who are your top 5 customers, so for example, and you have got 2 trillion data into the table. So in order to get that information from the 2 trillion records in MS SQL database, it takes, say, around more than 6 hours in order to get your query answered, right? Just try to understand. Okay, now thing is that more than 6 hours just for execution time is basically required, more than 6 hours in order to get that, just the query top 5 customers, because see your data volume, 2 trillion records. But in case of a SAP HANA, so for example, the same records you have got in, 2 trillion records you have got in HANA. What is the time taken for that? What would be the time taken for execution of this? Less than 6 seconds. Same 2 trillion data records, and I have got the same query, who are my top 5 customers among I am running the query among my 2 trillion records. Okay, in HANA, see the performance timing, 6 seconds, less than 6 seconds it takes. So you understand that the way that underlying, the architecture has been developed in such a manner that this is a huge performance, significantly improved, and that is the kind of performance impact HANA can give. So you are recommending to as HANA as a solution to any client, majorly for the performance factor, because there are many companies, say like banking industry, every day they used to handle, say like, million, trillion of records across different countries. So very difficult for them to handle, in a separate database, in another database who are actually taking, such kind of hell lot of time in order to get the query answered. But if you use HANA over here, what happened, and judiciously you have modeled your object, what happened, you see the performance difference in HANA. Okay, so this is one of the major reason that you are recommending HANA, as a performance, as far as the performance is concerned, to the client. Okay, so over here, remember one thing, that ABAP code, which you are basically using for your code to model scenario, is basically do sequential processing. As I just mentioned, that any database table, if you're running in, if you're reading it into the ECC, it will do a sequential processing. Even for ABAP also, like if you are writing some code in ABAP, it will actually execute in a sequential processing manner in order to give you the result. Whereas SQL scripting is basically does parallel processing. It is responsible for parallel processing. That is the way it has been designed. Okay, so of course you understand the moment I'm talking about parallel processing, so significantly you have got your time gets improved because you are doing multitasking at the same time, isn't it? Okay, so one more thing, today's class will be 1.5 hours, so like till 9:30, and same as like tomorrow also, tomorrow's class will be also like for 1.5 hour. And then from next week, I think next Saturday will be probably off. I will confirm it tomorrow after talking to the the organizers, and we'll be having class on Sunday again for 3 hours. Okay, so that is a communication I have received from the organizer so far. So okay, so till this point, is it clear? This particular slide, is it clear to you, everybody? Okay, so Arun, Ashwin, Venkat, whoever is the new joiners, are you finding it interesting as a subject, SAP HANA, because this is your first class? So do you find it interesting subject? I mean, do you think that this is an interesting, tool to be known? Or say like, are you understanding that what exactly we are talking about? Arun, Ashwin, and Venkat. Arun, Ashwin, I'm not getting any answer for them. Arun said yes, very limit, I mean short answer, so I'm not sure. Okay, what about Ashwin?
Sorry.
Yeah, my question is that do you find this subject interesting, and do you find that
I'm familiar with Sybase IQ. I think it uses the same columnar storage, yes, with the compression, so I'm familiar with these ones.
Okay, so far it is comfortable with you, right? I mean, no such complications or anything?
Yes.
Okay, fine. Thank you. Okay. Now, thing is that, so till this point it is clear. So let us just go to the another page. Okay. Inside the CPU, what is core? So central processing unit, we know that this is a computer, so for example, And I have central, something called central processing unit, which is basically responsible for all your executions of your program. Central processing unit, because this is a processing unit, which is basically, that's what we say, that what is a processor speed, because it's important that, because execution speed depends on the central processing unit, okay, that how fast it will actually act or how fast it will give you the result, right? Now, this central processing unit is basically made of different cores. Sorry, order not in centers. Different, I said cores. So inside your computer, what happened? You have got multiple cores. Core is nothing, but these are the small central processing unit. This is responsible for processing of your data. So this is the same unit for processing your data. Altogether, it's called central processing unit. Now, in case of traditional SAP system, in case of ABAP, say for example, once you execute a code which is written in ABAP, once you execute a program which is written in ABAP in the traditional SAP system, it engages only one core. Only one core. So do you understand what I said? Like only a single core is basically responsible for its all execution. So like if you have got multiple programs, you have got multiple programs. Sequentially, each and every programs one by one gets executed. Okay. And it engages only one core to process the entire program. So for example, if you have got a complex code, it is not getting broken down to any simpler or smaller portions and then get it executed. The entire code, bottom end to end, so like, you know, start to end or end to end execution of the code, if you say it's a complex code, the entire complex code is actually will be using only a single core of the CPU or the computer in order to process the ABAP code. Whereas if you come to the scenario of SAP HANA, what is happening? Say for example, you have got a complex code being written into SAP HANA using SQL scripting, say for example. That complex code gets broken down to smaller pieces of code. Okay. And the smaller pieces of code being occupied by each and every core. Okay, so what happened? Like, you know, the whole program is basically been complex program been broken down to, you know, smaller pieces of the code, and each code is basically using different core. Each code is basically being engaged or occupied by different cores. So what is happening? Parallel processing happening, right? Because you have got a complex code altogether in the scenario. And what is happening is that, you know, this code got broken down. So you have got a complex code over here. And this code is basically being broken down to a multiple smaller portion of the code. Okay. And what happened? Different portions of the code, and each portion is actually what happened. Each portion being used by different CPU, different core of this this computer. And what happened, like, you know, so multiple processing is happening at the same time. Okay, so each code is being processed by different core of the CPU. So whatever the code is getting generated by the system inside the each CPU, there are multiple cores is actually present over there. Okay, so complex programs, what happened, which gets generated, they break broken down to the smaller parts, and each part of your program is processed in a different core of the CPU. Different core of the CPU is processing. Now, all the core is basically being engaged to process their own part. So everybody is actually processing their own part. So whatever has been part been assigned to the core, they are processing their own part. They are responsible for their own part. But what about the results? As I just mentioned, that what about the result? Like, you know, result, how, I mean, they will accumulate the results. So they, once the processing is completed, they will accumulate the result and give it back to the user. Okay. So massive parallel processing actually trying to engage the all CPUs of the computer, because each and every CPU is basically a combination of different cores. So the moment a complex program got basically been broken down to smaller portions of programs, so every core being engaged or occupied by you know, the smaller portion of the programs, and then it is getting executed and it is accumulating the result and ultimately giving it to the user. Okay, so one by one, it is not single-handedly, it is not giving the its you know, result to the user. It is accumulating the result and giving it to the user. Okay, so this is called massive parallel processing. Okay, so just understand the difference between the traditional SAP system and the this SAP HANA system. Is basically the difference is the in the traditional SAP system, you have got the coding languages above and it is code to model, that is architectures, whereas SAP HANA is model to code kind of architectures, whereas you are creating a model into the system and system automatically generated a code into the background of it. Okay, secondly, ABAP is basically the language which has been used into the SAP normal traditional SAP system in order to fulfill their business logic, but whereas SQL scripting gets used for SAP HANA. And third thing is that, as I just mentioned, that in case of a you know, ABAP, it is basically for executions of any programs, complex programs, the entire program gets executed sequentially using only a single core of the system, just a single core into the system. Whereas in case of a HANA, basically the complex program got broken down to different smaller portions of the programs, and each small program being executed by the you know, different cores of the CPU, and all the activities or all the, you know, functions actually you know, it is basically being happened and parallelly, but at the time of execution of the result, basically the result gets accumulated from different cores, and then ultimately, after accumulation, it is basically, I mean, it is basically available to the user. Okay. Okay. So in general, remember one thing, that once you were working on HANA, once you were started to working on HANA, 75% of understanding is basically, just imagine that, see, till now, we still not have logged into the system. Have you noticed that? We are still discussing about the conceptual part, because this is very important. If you look into the system, if you log into the system, you will just see just a drag and drop, right? It is just the drag and drop, nothing else. Like 25%, it's very easy, just a drag and drop of the objects and you create the model. So nothing to understand as such over there in as a tool, because it is a tool. The main point is that we are emphasizing and we are repeatedly talking and discussing the same topic over and over. The reason being, 75% is basically you should understand the architecture of HANA for which you are here, and understand the business logic that for which you are. It needs to be very, very clear, very important point, that your business logic needs to be clear to you, that what kind of technical activity you are going to do into the system. So the moment you are ensured about it, that about the architecture and your business need, that what exactly you're going to the system, then it is just 25% of your job just to drag and drop the object and just you know, create the model. So now thing is that if somebody will ask you that, you know, that why should you recommend HANA as a solution, there are many other solutions into the market also. So why HANA? I mean, there are many other database integrations and any other very, very widely used solutions are also present. Why you are recommending HANA? first point is that it is very important point is that it is very easy to implement, you know. Once you understand, that's what I am repeatedly saying, once you are okay and confident about the background architectures and your business need, that why do you have to create models, what kind of models you need to create into the system, it is very easy to implement. Second point is that very easy to maintain. It doesn't have much of a complexity as far as the maintenance is concerned. It's very simple and it is an integrated solution, because what happened, the database and your application service are basically coming together. The moment you are logging into your HANA Studio, I mean, that is called, that is the application server, we call it HANA Studio, where you are going to do your modeling. So it is automatically retrieving the data sets from the underlying database. So it is an integrated solution. So very easy to maintain. So you don't have to go to a source system or a, so like, you know, to a target system in order to understand the nature of its quality, or say like, you know, analyze some, you know, different complex logics. It's not something like that. And third point is that profitability from business perspective. See, this point you need to consider, isn't it? You are recommending HANA as a solution to your clients, right? So of course they will see that, you know, in the long run, is it, the version is going to change each and every day, the support pack is coming each and every day, whether HANA is coming with a different bugs or different fixes every day, or say like, if I invest on HANA, purchasing HANA as a solution, you know, as a client, then is it going to change again? SAP will actually discontinue this SAP HANA and come up with some other technology again. Then I have to purchase after 1 year again some more licenses and a new technology altogether. Is it? Of course, I mean, if you are investing, if you're a client and if you're investing to a new technology, these are the questions, of course, will be coming, because it's a huge investment. So I will always see that what is my profitability perspective in terms of my 10 years plan, or say like at least 5 years planning, whether I need to purchase more softwares, I need to purchase more and more patches, upgraded versions and this and that. And so, because this is a challenging question in case of end users, because I actually am from a banking industry. So I'm implementing HANA, that is fine for my user, you know, data protections, or you know, execution performance factors and all and so on. I understand that, but I also see that, you know, this solutions what you're giving me, the technology what you're offering me, should go at least for next 5 years planning. It should help me in my next 5 years planning. Otherwise it is not possible, isn't it? With investment of such a huge on a technological area, it's not possible, right? So profitability from the business perspective is very important. The reason being that HANA is a very, very dynamic tool. Using HANA only, if you actually have a HANA as a basic platform, you can implement other components as well into your system. That is the way things are getting integrated. Okay, so that is the reason it is basically one point solution. So there are three reasons that, you know, why you should recommend HANA to your client. As I just mentioned, it's very easy to implement. Once, remember, you understand the architecture and you understand the business logic, what you actually need to do technically into the system. That is the first challenge what you need to do. Second point, it is very easy to maintain. It is not something that you have to go here and there to understand the, you know, technology and, you know, where the fixes. It is very easy to fix the problem if there is any. Third is that, as I just mentioned, that once you are recommending to the business, they should understand that the profitability perspective, this is a more stable solution, because it is going to run for at least for a few years without any kind of problems. Okay, so this is the important part to understand. So till this point, is it clear so far? Okay, now thing is that we do have also two scenarios in SAP HANA while you are actually recommending HANA to the client. One is called means, what does it mean? Sorry, this one is main car, like car is actually all together. Main car scenario. So I said, while you are recommending HANA to any customer, there could be two types of implementation scenario. One is sidecar scenario, one is called main car scenario. Okay, so sidecar scenario is something that, you know, where actually you have got already, you know, some business solution running, like, you know, SAP Business Warehouse already running into your platform, but you also like to have your all the HANA features enablement, because HANA is basically the self-sufficient and self-motivated solution. So even though I have SAP BW like Business Warehouse, but HANA is also an SAP product, so I would like to have all my, you know, all the benefits of HANA, what it is actually giving to our data warehouse. So I can actually implement or install HANA on top of my SAP BW, which is a Business Warehouse, which is my existing solution. So that is called sidecar scenario. In case of a main car scenario, by name you can understand that it is basically from the scratch. Like, I don't have any other solution, SAP solution running. Okay, I am basically using it, say for example, straight away as a final solution. Okay, from the greenfield project. So that is basically called a main car scenario. So implementations can be in two types in HANA, as I just mentioned, sidecar scenario and main car scenario. Sometimes this question also comes into the picture. Okay, that what are the types of you know, implementations you can expect from as far as HANA projects are concerned. Okay, so this is important. Okay, now there is one last topic what I'll be discussing today, and I'll be closing today's discussion, that is called the data migration. So HANA, what are the source systems? Like, you know, HANA can take data from where? From where actually you can take data? That is also important question, right? I mean, it should come to your mind that actually from where are you taking data? I understand that you are doing this and that, writing complex programs and so on. I understand. But what are the source of the data? Okay. Source system could be HANA can take data either from SAP source system or non-SAP source system. Okay, you have got a HANA into your landscape. This is your native HANA, SAP HANA box. And these are the source systems. So what are the type of source systems you can take? You can actually receive data from SAP source system, or you can also receive data from the non-SAP source system. That is fine. Okay. Okay. Now, how the data get transferred? Like, you know, I understand SAP source system is there, non-SAP source system is there, like flat file is there. But how do I take data into HANA? So depending on the source system and depending on your requirement, that how frequently you need the data, there are different data transfer technique or data migration technique available for HANA. In HANA's terminology, the data migration technique, like, you know, the data transfer technique, simple language, from the source system to the HANA system, data transfer technique is called data provisioning. So in HANA, somebody will ask you, not they won't ask you, what are the types of data transfer methods available? Okay, so thing is that it is talking about that it is basically called data provisioning. They will ask you that how the data gets provisioned. Provision means how the data get stored in SAP HANA or come in SAP HANA. Okay, so that is called using your requirement, like whether it is a daily requirement, how often you actually need the data. In the sense, SAP HANA is basically suppose a real-time transaction, right? Real-time transaction means I am doing a banking transactions, and Right now only SAP HANA, and I'm doing it into the SAP ECC, which is source system. And the moment I post my transaction, it is immediately available also in SAP HANA. So that is real-time processing. Earlier, it was not available for any other database. Nobody could give it, this real-time processing. Okay, that you are doing a transaction immediately, that is available into your source, into your target system. That is basically was not available. This feature was not available before SAP HANA. And SAP HANA is in this landscape is your target system. So this data provisioning is basically nothing but the data transfer methodology. And depending on your source systems, whether it is SAP or non-SAP, there are different types of, source data provisioning methods are available. One few of them is basically like, for example, SLT. We will be discussing it later on with the detailed class. This is just for your information. Thing is that then next is basically SLT, like SAP Landscape Transformation. This particular type of transformation or data migration technique is important as far as the real-time processing is needed. So if the client needs that, okay, I always need up-to-date data. Like right now, whatever is happening, I need the data. So you need to actually use SLT as your data provisioning method in order to use your real-time data. There is one called data services or business object data services. Okay, so once you actually need some data which is coming into the batch, like, you know, if you are actually having some batch processing data, say for example, if you have got some scheduled job and then, you know, you would like to have it into the system, you know, into the HANA system. So batch processing, so for example, there is a scheduled job into the whole night and a report based on that you would like to see tomorrow morning. So this scheduling of the job does happen by using business this data services. Okay, there is one more method. There are different methods, but most popular methods I'm just mentioning. There is something called smart data access, which means that basically here you are physically not bringing the data into SAP HANA. What you are doing is that you are virtually accessing the data from some other source system. This is mainly important for non-SAP source systems. This SD is actually applicable for the non-SAP source systems cases exclusively. It is not available for the SAP source systems, okay? But in case of SLT, what you can do is that SLT can take data either from the SAP or non-SAP source system. Same as with DS, data services or business object data services, it can take data from the SAP and non-SAP data sources, whereas smart data access can actually take data only from the non-SAP source systems. There is something called flat file, like, you know, even though if you have got some flat file Excel sheet into your desktop, that also you can access it through SAP HANA. So this is also applicable only for, you know, non-SAP source system, flat file. And then it is actually coming to SAP HANA. Okay. So this is the data provisioning method. We'll be having separate modules for understanding each and every data provisioning methods, how it happens, what is the significance of it, what are the challenges and what are the features. We'll be discussing more on that. But this is the overall process, and the technology name, as I just mentioned, data provisioning, which is nothing but data transfer methodology. Okay. So our class is basically is an end. Okay, and Pratik is actually, let us just see that what are the questions I have got it. One second. Pratik is asking that SLT is SLT full form. It is SAP Landscape Transformation. That is a full form. Pratik is asking one more question. Can it take data directly from the social media? That is his question. So Pratik, actually, it is taking data from the social media, which is basically a non-SAP source system. It can take, but thing is that, okay, like if there is any kind of business logic being in, been implemented, or say like, you know, for the structuring of the data set, if it doesn't understand, then we have to maybe convert it into some flat file or so, or say like, you know, or any some kind of, acceptable media so that SAP HANA can understand it. Because in HANA, what happened, everything is being stored into the tabular format. Okay, like data, whatever you are taking is basically should be into the tabular format, into the table-based format. Because you are actually executing the columnar database, like columnar tables. So everything has to be into the columnar table format. So even though you are taking a social media data, so you have to write somewhere the logic either into the this in some of your any of your data provisioning tool, so that it comes in SAP HANA. Once it will come to SAP HANA, it should be in a tabular format. So the logic can be here, or logic can be somewhere there in into your source system as well. Okay, so directly even this from the social media, basically it won't the kind of manipulations what you need to do is either over here or maybe into your source system. As I just mentioned, that maybe you have to dump the data into a flat file and then you are actually load it into the data provisioning method and make it a tabular in a tabular representation available into SAP HANA. Okay, so till this point, is it clear for everybody? And is it interesting so far? Because this data provisioning method is exclusively for SAP HANA.